Following is a local resident producers program. The program content is the sole responsibility of the producer and does not necessarily reflect the views or policies of CATV2, Oshkosh Community Media Services, the City of Oshkosh, or Time Warner Cable.
Hi everyone, welcome to I in Oshkosh. Cheryl Hentz here along with Dan Rylance. Very pleased on this edition to welcome a newcomer to our show. She's never been on before, but hopefully over the years we'll have her back again. Peggy West is here. She is the Food Services Director for the Oshkosh Area School District. We're going to be talking about a number of things during this half-hour segment, including a small rate increase in the price of school lunches. We'll find out, you know, how much the increase is and why, and then just talk about different issues related to the school lunch program as it is. So thanks very much for being
welcome,
here.
Peggy.
We appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
And hopefully people can't hear the rain pouring outside the windows as we talk. Let's just hope the lights stay on. So anyway, I guess the first place to start would be approximately how many students does the program serve in Oshkosh Area School District?
We serve an average of 4,800 school lunches per day to our students alone, and then we probably serve another 500 meals to children at Grace Lutheran, Trinity Lutheran, Oshkosh Christian. We have two daycares, one Head Start program, and all the adults. So we're right about 5,300 meals per day.
Okay. Well, that's interesting about the, you know, these extra little programs, if you will, because those are in some cases parochial schools.
Yes, they are.
How does, that's a cooperative type contract, I'm assuming, that
it
they
is.
Have with
it's
us?
An agreement that we have actually with the school district and the state of Wisconsin, and because our meals meet all the requirements of the National School Lunch Program, then those schools have that as well.
Okay. Now, of this 5,300 or thereabouts, about what percentage or about what actual number of students would you say are considered low income?
Actually, last year about 49% of those meals served were two children that were eligible for either the free meals or the reduced price meals.
Okay. What's the income threshold that someone has to meet or be under in order to qualify for that reduction?
Well, if you have a family of four, typical family of four, two adults and two children, you have to be less than $39,220 per year, which is about $32.69 per month.
Okay.
Less than that to be eligible for either the free or reduced price meals.
That's fairly generous.
And, yeah.
Yeah. And that's the upcoming figures for the next school year.
Okay.
Cheryl, ask her, how about breakfast, just as long as we're
Yes,
yes.
We do serve breakfast.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
What do we do for breakfast?
We serve about 730 breakfasts per day last year.
Okay.
And the numbers for the free and reduced in those is much higher. Yeah. We actually serve about 74% of those meals for the children that were eligible for free or reduced price meals.
Yeah.
Wow, okay. Now, do we have a similar agreement with these daycares and other parochial schools for breakfast program?
Not yet.
Okay.
We have.
Sounds like it's coming, though, huh?
Well, it may. We started running a separate truck just to manage our breakfast programs because there are 11 of those. And so it's a whole nother program, required more trucking, so we run a separate truck
okay.
for those.
Now, what's your budget?
We actually have a $2.8 million budget.
Okay.
And our money is kept separate from the rest of the school district. That's an agreement. Another agreement, USDA requires us to keep our money separate from the regular district funds. So our money actually comes from the federal government. Large portion, over $1 million, come from your federal tax dollars. And then another large portion is state funding. State funding is about $75,000 a year, And the rest of the money comes from what we charge for school lunches. So for the most part, it's just those three funding sources.
Okay. Well, just a follow-up question on that, Dan, before I toss it over to you. You said from the better majority of it comes from federal and state funding. Mm-hmm. The state funding, is any portion of that coming from our property taxes, if you will, that we pay in and that end up getting filtered off to the state and that we don't see back in the form of shared revenues? You don't know, probably.
I really don't
know.
All
right.
I just
fair.
Know that it's part of your state tax dollars, and some of it comes back to the community.
Okay, that's fair. Go ahead, Dan.
Break down the Fed a little bit. Is a lot of that million just food?
The way that actually works, households can apply for free or reduced price meals for their families, and based on the income that we just talked about. And then the children that are eating for free, we get reimbursed for those meals.
Okay.
And for the current school year, the children that ate free meals, we got $2.47 back for each meal served to a child that was eligible for free meals last year. We got $2.07 for the children that were eligible for the reduced price meals.
Okay.
So that's a shared. The family pays 40 cents, and then the federal government gives us $2.07. And then we get 23 cents for every meal we serve to the children that eat at full price as well.
Okay.
It's a fully federally funded program.
Okay. But do you get USDA food?
And yes,
you do.
Food. And last year, I believe the amount was $160,000 in food. And that's through the USDA Commodities Program.
Right.
And the federal government basically pulls commodities off the market, stabilizes the price, and puts those products into the National School Lunch Program. What's interesting about a lot of those products, and a lot of people don't realize it, is that when the government pulls products off of the market, you know, they pull whole chickens, they pull sides of beef, they pull, you know, a half of a pig or whatever it is they're going to pull. We take a lot of those products and at the state level actually make them into things that children will eat, such as chicken patties, chicken nuggets, ground beef patties. They take the ground beef and grind it up for us, and then that comes into the school district.
Somebody processes it in Madison? All of this?
The Department of Public Instruction actually has contracts with different
privatized, but
so we have to pay for some of that processing.
Yeah.
But there is some control then on the quality of the products that we're getting back, because they write specifications. They say, you know, this chicken patty cannot have more than X amount of sodium or X amount of fat, and how it has to be prepared.
So there's no regular pattern of what commodities they would pull off the market, or is it pretty standard?
There's pretty standard. There's usually a pretty good supply of the fruits and vegetables, and they'll pull a lot of apples. We get applesauce offered a lot. We get peaches offered a lot. There's pears from time to time, peaches from time to time. We get beef on a fairly regular basis. We get offered a lot of chicken. And unfortunately, I do have to turn down some of the chicken that's offered because a lot of it's being processed into breaded products. And I don't think we should offer all those breaded products to our children.
How's your nacho supply?
Pretty good.
Is it good?
Yeah, it's pretty good.
That's one of the kids' favorite.
That is,
We
serve that at the high school only now.
Yeah, well, they're not pleased with that at the elementary.
No, they're not pleased with that.
Yeah.
Why the change?
Changes. Actually, it was the year before last year. We started weeding out some of those menu items that were higher in fat.
Okay.
And that met that requirement, as well as the mini corn dogs. We pulled both of those, and we took them away gradually. So we offered them about four times in the year before this past year, and then we took them out and tried to replace it with other items that we thought the kids would be interested in. But sure, I still hear about it.
Go ahead.
Yeah, dietary guidelines, you know, you kind of touched on that just a little bit with some of these things having higher amounts of fat. Mm-hmm. Who establishes the dietary guidelines, and from there then, who actually plans the meals? Does your staff or do you plan the meals based on the guidelines, or Give us some sense of how that works.
The National School Lunch Program, National School Breakfast Program, the After School Snack Program, the Special Kindergarten Milk Program, those are all USDA programs under that whole umbrella of child nutrition. So USDA pretty much dictates what we can offer and what we can't offer.
Okay.
USDA specifically states that you must offer children 2 ounces of protein. You must offer 3/4 of a cup of fruits and vegetables from 2 sources to your little kids and a cup to your big kids. You must offer the milk, and you must offer 12 servings of breads, grains per week to the little kids and 15 to the big kids. There's no question about that. We have to meet that requirement. Along with that, they tell us you may not offer more than 30% fat. You may not have more than 2,000 milligrams of sodium. You must have vitamin A, C, iron. And the Department of Public Instruction is our basically our regulatory agency, and they come once every 5 years, and they take our menus and analyze everything right down to the ketchup. And they basically go through all of the recipes, everything we've purchased, and then give us a nice printout of what we've been serving. And it's based on what the children actually consume, which is kind of interesting. So, I mean, I can put out a perfect menu, and if they don't eat it, then it goes right out the window. So sure. It's based on what the children are actually consuming. The menus then, we basically pull last year's menus forward. We just change the date. We make some adjustments for time off. Mm-hmm. We also make adjustments based on what we think the children liked in the prior year, didn't like, or what we need to make changes in. And that was, you know, the mini corn mm-hmm. dog. So we made some changes and things like that. Once we have kind of the basic menu set up, then it gets distributed to our 6 cooks and 6 assistant cooks and our 2 kitchen supervisors, and they take a good look at it as well.
And how long does it take you to put a menu together for an upcoming school year, and when do you start doing that?
Well, we actually have September's pretty well underway right okay. now. So. We, because of the printing and the timelines and getting it on the web, we pretty much start the beginning of the prior month.
Okay.
Just to make sure we get it to the printer and get it distributed.
Sure.
We do print enough menus to actually distribute 1 per child to all of our little children, mm-hmm. and then we have them available in the middle schools. And high school students don't much care till they get in line. And then it's like, what are we having?
Yeah, yeah.
So
you basically, you're just doing 1 month at a time. It's
yep.
not like you're preparing something for the whole year.
So oh, no. I tried
big
to do that once.
Task.
Yes, I tried to do that once, but we get a lot more flexibility if we can do it monthly, and we can make adjustments then if we find a new menu item, if we want to do some experimenting.
Okay.
Yeah. I was a lunchroom supervisor at Webster Stanley Elementary
okay.
School from
Great.
2003 to 2005.
All right.
I had second and third graders every day, okay?
Okay.
And in preparation for this, I have 2 or 3 observations, and I want you to kind of respond to them.
All right.
One was, the most upsetting thing to me was the tremendous amount of food that was thrown away every day.
Yeah.
I mean, it was just unbelievable, mm-hmm. you know, and I'm thinking of people starving. And I came up with 2 reasons why I think that was. One is, some days, the minute they walked in there, they weren't going to eat it. And then it was already down the line, we're having blank today. The second was, they don't have enough time to eat.
Yes.
I don't know why they have such short periods. But you know, when they get in, you know, they come out of recess, or I bring them out of the lunch or out of the playground, they come in, and they have to sit by class.
Mm-hmm.
But for 80% of their time, they're talking to each other.
Mm-hmm.
And then
mm-hmm.
there's 3 minutes left, and they try to gobble their food down.
Yes.
And there's not enough time.
Right.
And their teachers are waiting out in the hallway.
Yes.
And you got to get them out because the 4th and 5th graders are ready to go in,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
The third thing was, a lot of people drank milk.
Yeah.
That wasn't a problem. And then I thought there was not necessarily a growing number, but a constant number of kids who'd brought their own lunches. You know, and some were really elaborate.
Yeah.
Some weren't 4 bags of potato chips. I mean, really healthy stuff, you know.
Yeah.
So there was that. But could you comment first on the... you know, a large amount of food that gets thrown out. How can you, any suggestions on that?
Well, that is a challenge. And I see it a couple different ways. Is children tend to, when everything is even, children will eat pretty much according to if their body needs it or not.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so you may see some children that actually have enough food at home and they're not going to eat. I see huge differences in the populations in some of our schools like Webster Stanley, Washington, and Jefferson versus the children out at Oakwood and Carl Traeger Elementary. The children at Webster Stanley and Washington, they will eat everything, uh-huh. no questions asked usually, and the children out in those other schools do turn down a number of items just because they get food elsewhere. We have something in the district that we call offer versus serve. Under the terms of offer versus serve, we must offer children all five of the meal components that, you know, the bread, the milk, the meat, and the two fruits and vegetables. They need only take three things on their tray.
Uh-huh.
Okay? So, and that's confusing for some children. Uh-huh. And it's easier for them sometimes to just take it all.
Okay.
And even though they might not want it, and it's going to go in the garbage.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think that that happens. I think that if you watch the garbage, which you probably did, you saw as much of the bag lunches, the home sack pack lunches go in the garbage as well.
And I can't quantify that.
Yeah,
I
just you can't
know,
quantify.
I just know they were two big buckets. I mean,
yes.
And they were almost full, but before the fourth and fifth graders get
yes.
there, and the custodian had to switch for
yep.
for a while. But you don't monitor. You don't. There's no way you really can monitor how much is thrown away on it.
We don't really monitor what's thrown away, but we can get a pretty good grip on if children like what we're serving based okay. on the turndowns.
Okay.
And also, we now offer something called a peanut butter and jelly Uncrustable
right.
as a second choice. Okay. And when that number goes real high, we know that that main entree is not a popular entree.
Okay.
So they have two choices now, and hopefully that's cut back
yeah.
somewhat.
I don't think
that
was
that
there
way.
When I was there. That must be new, huh?
That's new.
Yeah,
yeah.
I'm getting older too. So
we've been doing that about 5 years, I think now, and that's quite popular.
Yeah.
But we can get a pretty good feel for if children like something or don't like something based on that yeah. count.
Anything, Peggy, that you've really seen that the kids, you know, you guys tried it, and the kids just say, "Ugh, we don't want this at all."
Oh yeah.
Tell us what some of those might be.
Surprisingly to me, it's that the barbecued rib patty, the little ones, and I would think that that would be a novel thing because of McDonald's and their McRib,
yeah.
and ours is virtually the same, but that meets a whole lot of resistance.
Hmm. Mm-hmm. Maybe you don't serve a toy with it. Maybe that.
Yeah, maybe
that's the deal.
Or
yeah.
a McDonald's label on it or something.
And Sloppy Joe. And that's apparently not an item that is served at home very much anymore. It is not, and if children don't have a good recognition of that, of an item, they're not going to choose it. So Sloppy Joe is not a big hit at all. That's a big peanut butter and jelly Uncrustable day, and pretty much we had to put those two items aside. Because, yeah, not only does that count go up for the peanut butter and jelly, but the overall number of children eating just drops.
So. All right. I just happened to think of something as we were talking. You know, you were talking about the number of meals that are served during the school year and so
mm-hmm.
forth. Right now we're into summer months.
Yes.
And summer school does go on for some students.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any program?
Mm-hmm.
There is.
Yes,
okay.
yes. We offer the summer food service program for children. It's basically an extension of the National School Lunch Program. And we are able to offer that free to every child, 18 or younger, that gets into line. And we are offering that at Webster Stanley mm-hmm. Elementary, Jefferson Elementary, and at Roosevelt Elementary, both breakfast and lunch.
Hmm.
So
you know what the kids are going to have tomorrow?
What?
They're going to have breaded chicken patty.
There we go.
Fresh baked bun,
mm-hmm.
fancy coleslaw,
fancy.
And chilled applesauce.
Well, applesauce is good. Yeah. You said it was served a lot, so
it's a commodity.
Yeah.
Yes.
Now let's talk a little bit about the rate increase.
Okay. Sure.
The school lunch cost is going up
yes.
with the start of the 08-09 school
mm-hmm.
year. What is it going up to, and why? I think it's because everything else
yeah.
is going up.
Well,
so that's
and you're exactly right. We're going up 10 cents. It's a modest increase. I have followed the articles across the country, and some schools are going 20, 25 cents. We're going 10, and we're going to watch it like a hawk. Mm-hmm. we've gotten some good news just recently. We found out that our federal money, our federal reimbursements, which is probably not good on a federal tax dollar, looking at that, but that's going to go up 4% for us, which is not nearly enough to cover what they expect the overall food cost to go up, but it is something. So hopefully between that increase and the 10 cent price increase, we'll be at least okay.
Okay.
So we're still looking at an elementary school lunch of $1.75. We still lag at least 10 to 20 cents behind our surrounding school districts in terms of of what we charge for school lunches.
Okay.
So it's still quite a good deal.
Okay. And one thing that I found kind of interesting is, you know, when I was in school, mm-hmm. You actually paid with money.
Mm-hmm.
That's no longer the thing, and it hasn't been for some time, right?
Well, at the high schools, we still do take cash in line. We will do that, I think, until our counterparts like McDonald's and some of these places start taking debit cards. We have what is called a family food service account. It's an electronic system. So all of our little children are given a five-digit PIN number, and as they go through the lunch line, they put their five-digit PIN number in a machine, and the high school students use their IDs, their student IDs.
Okay.
And that's when it's either pinned in or scanned in, that information goes right to the central computer where it looks up the family and says, haha, you're eligible for free meals. We're not going to charge you, but we are going to note that you'd had lunch. And similarly, it'll look at the account, and if it's a full price meal and there's money in the account, then that meal goes through without a glitch.
Okay. So. And so why did you all go to that system? Was it because the littler ones were losing their lunch money, or was this just more of an efficient way, or maybe
a
combination
much,
of
much
both?
More efficient way to keep track of all of that. Plus, it's a lot more convenient for families.
Mm-hmm.
Families can pay one check. They can pay online, and they can cover all of the children. It's much more centralized. So we're not having to handle as much money as we used to in the past.
Okay. And then if they start running low in their account, if you will, throughout the year, they what, just pay online or whatever?
They can
one
pay
of these
online,
choices and they build up their account.
Mm-hmm. They can pay me, they can pay the school.
Okay.
We try to send home notices in a timely manner to say, your account is getting low, you need to send some money. We do tell the high school students, you know, you need to get some money in here, but high school students usually, if they're out of money in the family account, they can use cash.
Do you see a lot of littler ones, especially at the start of the school year, who they forget their PIN number?
Oh, yes.
And then what happens?
well, what we're doing this year, and we did last year, but I think we're improving upon it, just before school starts, all of our families are going to get a letter. And the letter is basically we'll tell them what their family balance is. It'll tell them what the PIN numbers are for their children. It'll give them a practice pad so the children can practice. And it tells them what their current status is, free, reduced, or full paid. We're kind of calling that the super letter, but we hope that goes out. The plan is that it'll go out 2 weeks before the school year starts. And believe it or not, families do work with their children. They do practice on that practice pad, okay. And that really helps. It's surprising, but a lot of students just cannot remember that number over the summer, so that's a good thing that they do that.
Mm-hmm.
We do have a little issue with our kindergartners, mostly because some of them don't know numbers.
Yeah.
So for the first part of the year, our staff will key them in, we'll put the numbers in for the children, and then they start working and practicing with it. So.
Okay, all right, good. And we're almost out of time, but I want to touch on this before we are out of time. You know, we hear so much these days about food recalls and food contaminated products that are contaminated, and you know, salmonella poisoning is the most recent one that I think I've heard. And you know, what does that do to a school lunch program if you all of a sudden get a phone call saying there's
it's happened
item? I'm sure.
Yeah.
what happens? What do you do?
Well, the good thing is we have an emergency contact and a secondary emergency contact at the state, at the Department of Public Instruction. So if something comes up, whether it's a commodity food or it's one of our regular food items, we get that information emailed or called depending on the urgency of it. And if I'm not around, then the second emergency person takes it. And we've actually had to pull items off the menu. Mm. And in very short notice, and actually drive around town with hamburger patties in my car to get them to the school so the children had something to eat. It has happened.
Wow.
And not just last year, we had our big walk-in refrigerator at West High go down completely. And we had to sub out an entire menu item with the peanut butter and jelly on Crustables. So these things do happen. We try to stay ahead of it. We will pull it off the menu if in doubt. If in doubt, it goes. There's okay. No questioning about it. I was so delighted with the whole tomato thing. Well, not really delighted, but we found out about the tomato issue like the second of the last day of school. So it's like, great, pull them. And we just took them right off. So okay. Whether they come back, we don't know. It depends on if they get cleared, that'll be good. And we never did serve spinach, so that was a good thing.
In a case like that, when you have to pull something, mm-hmm. does the district get credit for that wasted product then, or?
It depends on the product. If it's okay. a commodity product, it usually gets put on hold.
Okay.
And then that's usually covered by the state in some way, shape, or form, okay. either in the form of another commodity. Okay. Or.
Quick parent questions.
Yes.
Why no salad bar offerings at the elementary level like they have in Nina?
That's a food safety issue for me.
Food safety issue
you
for
bet.
You. Okay.
Yes, because you have a lot of little children that don't always wash their hands, and they're okay. touching the same tongs, and sometimes they're not using tongs okay. at all. So okay. that's definitely.
Just kind of reaching in and grabbing?
Yeah, right. that.
least favorite menu item on the menu, is chicken and gravy still on the menu?
It is. It is.
No chance it's going off.
You know, that's a hard one for us because the chicken's a commodity.
I understand, and you said you get a lot of chickens.
And you know what? Our adults really love that menu.
Okay.
So it's not the worst.
Okay.
It's not the worst. So.
And then mucho nachos are not coming back to the elementary.
Not to the little ones.
Oh, what no. a disappointment.
You know, it's also very difficult to serve with the
oh, I understand
nachos
that.
And the cheese
yeah,
sauce
yeah, yeah,
and the
but
meat.
But they really like it.
I know they really
yeah,
like it.
Okay.
They'll have to wait till high school.
Okay. All right.
Or Taco John's.
I have one other quick question for you, Peggy. You know, some families are practicing diet dietitians. You're right.
Yes.
That's you. Yes. You're a dietitian. some are practicing vegetarians
yes.
and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
What kinds of accommodations are made with the lunch program for people with either special dietary needs or choices?
Okay. There's actually a couple issues there. The one is a special dietary need. If we can get documentation from a physician that a child has a special dietary need and what we need to make substitutions, we will do that. I have a number of children actually that get substitutions on the National School Lunch Program menus. I basically X something off and write yeah. something new in. And we've had all kinds of allergies. We've had allergies to pork. We have, you know, pretty severe milk allergies, lactose allergies. We've had citrus, vitamin C allergies, those sorts of things that we will make substitutions for.
Okay.
When it's documented by a physician or another medical authority. The other one, the vegetarian issue, is a little bit more challenging because that's a by choice.
Okay.
So families can choose to take the school lunch or they can choose to pack it. Now over the years I've kind of figured out that we have very few of what is a true vegetarian, someone that follows the guidelines of a vegetarian, knows how to match the legumes with whatever, the grains, to come up with the right protein.
Sure.
But we do have a lot of children that just prefer not to eat as much meat. And we can accommodate that by offering cheese pizza, the peanut okay. butter and jelly. We've tried putting like hard-cooked eggs out there for salads. We've tried refried beans. Those don't go so well. Okay. So we've got a ways to go with some of that, but
good. Well, listen, thanks so much for being here.
Thank you.
We had other
questions,
but we don't have time for
them. Well, I'll have to come back. Yeah.
Absolutely. We hope that you will. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
We're going to take a short break. When we come back, we'll be joined by Richard Spanbauer, who is a Republican candidate for the 53rd Assembly District. We'll be right back.
We just escaped.
I escaped.
I escaped.
By foot.
Run across the border.
I couldn't practice my religion.
I was put to work in the forced labor camps.
If I stay in Cambodia, I would have been dead by now.
If you think differently, then you're an enemy.
If you know how to read and write, you're dead. You speak your mind, you're dead.
The only way to express what I wanted to do was to get out.
I got to the country when I was about 14 years old.
I was 20.
I was 24.
I came here with nothing. No money, no English.
America stood for freedom, it stands for freedom, and that's why all my generation, young generation, wanted to be there.
For the first time, I felt like I have a right to be on this earth.
Here, you can do whatever you want to do.
I love my life here. I feel at home.
I'm free to do what I want.
Freedom to me means my life.
How you doing?
Hi.
Hi. Have a nice day.
You too.
Thanks.
If only child abuse were this easy to recognize. If you even suspect abuse, call 1-800-4-A-CHILD. All calls are anonymous and confidential. Trust your instincts.
Poor nutrition today will increase Sarah's chances of anemia, add to her healthcare costs, sick days, even stunt her ability to learn. And the thing is, Sarah's not even born yet. Get proper nutrition before it's too late. Call or visit WIC. WIC provides nutrition information, healthcare referrals, even food. Your child has you, and you have WIC.
Back to the second half of I on Oshkosh, and we're very pleased to be joined now by Richard Spanbauer. We know him as Dick. He's been here many times in the past, and so he is seeking once again, making his third attempt at winning a seat to represent the 53rd Assembly District. He is a Republican. He has run twice previously against Carol Owens, and you've made a little headway each time.
Yeah, the last election was super close.
Yeah, but this time Carol is not seeking re-election, so Dick, I think, is hoping that he can get his foot in the door this time around. But anyway, thanks very much for being here. It's good to see you.
Well, I really thank you for inviting me, because it's the one way of getting out your message to people, for that matter.
What I just mentioned, you know, you are running as a Republican. You've got three other challengers.
Four.
I'm talking about in the Republican race.
That's four.
Well, now, see, I've seen two different things. I've seen three, and then I've seen four.
We've had him jump in rather late.
Okay. And then there's a Democratic challenger
as well. He jumped in late, too, in June.
Yeah. And so your primary will be held on September 9th.
Mm-hmm.
And then the winner of that will go on to face Jeff Mann, the Democratic candidate. And the general election will be on Tuesday, November 4th. Mm-hmm. So anyway, like I said, it's good to have you here again. You know, some people who have, you know, seen you here before, they pretty much know all about you. But for those who don't, or maybe they have forgotten, tell us a little bit about Dick Spanbauer.
Well,
you're running.
First of all, I'm chairman for the town of Algoma, and I'm also chairman for the Winnebago Towns Association. I've served in government many, many, many years, either elected or appointed or volunteered. I like serving. I've served many, many years. I've been on probably every committee that one can think of, planning and zoning, water committee, cable TV committees. Anything that was out there, whether it's an appointment or a volunteer system, I enjoy working with the towns. And I guess I enjoy even working with the towns as their chairman, the Winnebago Towns Association. There are 16 towns in the district. I am running because we need a strong voice down in Madison, and we need somebody that understands the municipalities, the governments, and how they work and how they interact, and how they should interact between Madison And I consider myself a middle person. In other words, a communicator between Madison and my constituency. And that's one thing, the biggest thing I was asked today on an interview is what do you have planned for your first term? And the very first things are to establish a communication with residents. One thing I have discovered in all the years I've run, whether it's been the assembly or a supervisor or a chairman's job, is the fact that people don't have as much faith in government. It seems to be waning the last number of years. And it's like people feel that we're out of touch. We get elected, we don't get back to them, we don't do the things that they would ask us to do.
With some justification.
With some justification. I mean, let's face it, we've had some bad things happen in Madison with scandals and different things. People going to jail, paying big fines or whatever have you. So it's like sometimes you go to somebody's door, not too often, but it does happen every election, and somebody says, oh, another corrupt politician. And they've kind of pinpointed us to that level. And it's quite disappointing, but I do expect it, so it doesn't really get me down. I understand where they're coming from. So basically, I think you have to establish your first term a communication level between Madison and your constituency. Mm-hmm. Whether it be the village of Oakville, or it be the city of Waupun, or the town of Omro, you have to be in touch with your people. That's my biggest thing that I would see in the first term.
Sure. Well, you've had real issues with Carol Owens over the years. And I think, if memory serves me correctly, Dick, one of the reasons that you got into the race originally was because you were, A, hearing complaints about how she was serving or not serving, and you just felt that you could do a much better job. And now, of course, she's not seeking re-election. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that comes, you know, with mixed feelings by different people. But do you see her not running as maybe an easier way for you to get your foot in the
door? Well, I'm sure it's always a easier time when the incumbent, you're not running against the incumbent. I mean,
but you have so many challengers now.
That's true, but there's one difference between me and the challengers. Neither one of them has ever served on a governmental body that I know of. Mm-hmm. And knowing a little bit about each one of them, nobody has really been on a city council or a town supervisor or even sat on a planning and zoning, mm-hmm. as far as I know at this point, and from my conversations with them. And that might be the biggest edge there besides name recognition. Now, I did well, very, very well, mm-hmm. in Fonelac County and Waupun. And I say that sidetrack in Winnebago, because when you come from Winnebago and you're going to Fonelac County or Waupun, if they don't know you, they won't not support you. Mm-hmm. I found that out the first time. There was areas there where people didn't wanted to change from Carol Owens, but they didn't know me, mm-hmm. so they voted for Carol Owens. Mm-hmm. And I've had people tell me that up until the last election. And then we broke ice there quite a bit, I might say. Mm-hmm. So I'm going on name recognition, but I don't take that for granted. Sure. I've been to every single board meeting. I think there's only two left out of the 20 towns. That's about it. So I'm meeting with all the chairmen, all the village presidents. If it's a mayor-alderman system like City of Waupun or the City of Omro, I'm trying to meet with everybody. And I go to their board meetings. I want to know what the issues are. But more importantly, you want that contact.
Okay. Before we get into issues, okay. with Carol not running, will that change how you're campaigning at all, or will you still campaign the way you always have?
Nothing is going to change. I'm still a candidate, and I have to campaign on the values that mm-hmm. I feel and the goals that I feel that we can advance the 53rd District. It's that simple.
Okay. All right.
And I don't really care to even go into much with Carol Owens, because she's retiring and that's the mm-hmm. end of it. Right, so exactly. I don't want to get on a kick here where we're, you know.
Well, right. I just thought that, you know, before, because you had, your territory is so huge.
It's phenomenal.
And, mm-hmm. you know, she had been there for so long. I mean, she was a mainstay in that district.
Yes.
And, you know,
yes.
so you really had to pound the pavement and beat the bushes.
Yep.
And now, you do have the name recognition. And more so probably, as you mentioned, than any of your opponents. So I just thought maybe that would change how you campaign a little bit.
Well, it's human nature to sit there and go, yeah, I gotta maybe made this election or a little easier. Maybe I do in the sense of the name recognition, mm-hmm. but you can't sit on that. I've been doing this for 30 plus years.
Yeah.
And I'm not a newcomer.
Sure.
And that might be something that a new candidate, that's run or been on office for a 2-year term and, gets that feeling, oh, yeah, he retired and I'm going to beat him. You still have to get out there and meet the public. You really do. Actually, the biggest advantage when you do that, you come up with a lot of issues from different people and you get different slants on different things. The people out there that are the voters probably know as much and more than you do on some issues that maybe you haven't looked at. Maybe you haven't looked at it as the perspective that they're talking to you about it, mm-hmm. and it gives you a different slant on things. So voter contact is enormous, and it should not change for any candidate, whether you've been doing this for 30 years or for 2 years.
Okay.
Tell me about the 53rd district a little bit, and my key question is, mm-hmm. is this district a safe Republican stronghold, or is it Republican because Carol Owens held that seat for so many years?
Well, that's a good question. In Fond du Lac County and Waupun, especially in some of the rural areas in Winnebago mm-hmm. County, they are pretty Republican. There's no question about that. What might be an interesting race as a opposite would be the state senate, because you're looking at the city of Fond du Lac, mm-hmm. city of Oshkosh, that could have a different bearing, mainly because you find there's
less
more
Republican.
Oh yes,
yeah, yeah.
in the cities especially.
Sure.
But no, I found that they're very conservative. My type of conservatism is I'm a moderate, and I'm a moderate to a point where I have Republican principles. But I've been accused of being a Democrat running as a Republican, and that really upsets me at times. But here's the thing. If a Democrat in the legislature has a great bill that is going to be very beneficial to the 53rd district, am I going to look at him and say, well, you know something, you got a great bill, but you're a Democrat and I'm a Republican, I got to vote the Republican way. I've often said, whether it's Carol Owens or any other, if it's a Democrat that's been in a long time, what incentive do you have to understand the bills if you know how you're going to vote, if you're going to vote the party line? I don't think voting the party line is any more in favor as much with the voter as it maybe even was 10, 15, 20 years ago. I think I'm hearing more because there's so many doors that I knock on. I'm constantly campaigning. It's almost a full-time job. Is the fact that we vote for the person, not the party. They may like a Republican if I come to the door, but they also want to know who the candidate is and what does that candidate he or she stand on. And that's the real issue.
What makes you a Republican? You've used the word conservative, moderate, but expand that. This is a Republican primary, so
sure.
what makes you a Republican?
Well, I believe in less government, less regulation. I believe in finding more ways to cut spending rather than finding always new programs yes. and throwing more money into programs. Okay. I think that's been an issue. I support strongly the Second Amendment. Okay. I'm pro-life okay. all the way. That's never changed, never will, for that matter. Pro-family values. There's a lot, I believe a lot in tax incentives, tax credits, any type of incentives. What I like about that aspect, and I like about what Bush did, and he won't get the credit that he will for the negative credit he'll get for the Iraq War, is the fact that he actually started the economy going after 9/11 with tax breaks, tax cuts, and you name it. He actually, any of your analysts, I study that the analyst sheet every single day, 5 days a week. I watch it, CNBC, never miss it. And most of them, if not all of them, that I've heard agree that cutting taxes and using tax credits and tax incentives is really the true way to get the economy going and to keep jobs. That's one of the reasons why I feel that instead of having a universal tax, or not a tax, a health plan, that sounds good. And I've also heard people mention to me on an interview that I should look at the aspect of guaranteeing that every person in the state of Wisconsin should have health insurance, a guarantee that we can make that applicable to everybody. That's a mouthful. I don't think people understand that what the humongous cost that could be and who's going to pay for it. The taxpayer will pay for it for sure, but business will pay for it. And the problem with business today wanting to expand is if they have to provide more health insurance to their people, they don't hire as many. Now, if we can give them tax credits, tax incentives, they might be more inclined to hire more people. When you hire more people, what happens? They're making money, okay, but they're paying taxes. So you get it back in the amount of taxes that's being paid, and you get your tax credits back, anything that you've given them on tax breaks, you get that back by keeping people working. That's where you need more revenue. You got to have people working. Most of all, you want to keep the jobs in Wisconsin, too. A lot of the jobs have left the state of Wisconsin.
Don't you think health care is a right of citizenship of every person who lives in the 53rd District?
You make a statement like everybody should be entitled
to it. Absolutely.
Yes.
We're the only industrialized country in the world that doesn't offer national
But you're talking about socialism, and I'm not a socialist.
What's socialism?
Socialism is the state takes care of everything for everybody.
Not everything. We have Social Security. Isn't that socialism?
Well, to a point.
Medicare?
Yeah.
Veterans benefits?
Yeah, but those are benefits. You said it.
But they're socialism.
Well, you asked me about health insurance,
yeah.
And I believe that if we can make it applicable for everybody to have health insurance, that's great, but at what expense? Nobody's talked about that.
But aren't people telling you in the 53rd District that that's a key issue?
It is a key issue, but is that the way to solve it, by just raising everybody's tax so everybody can have health insurance? Let me ask you this. To a certain degree, and I'm not against having people where they can be access to health insurance, but what would that cost? Do you have any idea what that could cost?
Dick, I mean, what is it costing now?
Yeah.
It's costing businesses, because we've got so many people who are either underinsured or not insured at all. Mm-hmm. That ultimately is costing the ones who are insured more money through higher premiums and so forth. It's also costing businesses more with higher premiums
Absolutely,
and so forth.
Absolutely, it is.
So.
Yeah.
They're already paying through the nose.
Well, to some degree, though, what is the incentive for somebody going to work if they can have health insurance and they don't have to go to work to earn a living, and by giving them a tax credit for health insurance? In other words, I guess what I'm saying, there is a certain margin, a percentage of people that want everything for free, but we also need people to work. If they want to go work, give them the health insurance. Give them a break on it. The ones that are willing to take the $6, $7, $8, $9 an hour jobs that people look at and go, oh man, by the time I pay taxes and I pay for my health insurance, there's nothing left. Why should I work? So you don't want to take the incentive away from somebody taking also the minimum wage jobs.
Oh, sure.
As well.
I, for one, am not saying give it to every single person free.
Well, that's what I'm hearing.
I'm just saying there ought to be a way, I think, that every single person in this country ought to be able to have some type of access to health insurance coverage. Charge them a minimal fee if need be or whatever, but I agree with Dan, it is a right of citizenship, I think.
It is, but I think you made a more clear statement than what you did. You were making it a blanket statement that everybody should have it, but you had no ramification for that. What you have said as far as giving the people the right to the access of it, sure, but to what capacity? And I think that's what has to be hammered out. I mean, they have to take a job. If they take a job, give them a tax credit on their health insurance, for that matter. Mm-hmm. Co-payments maybe are exempt or something like that, you know. Mm-hmm. Badge of Care I like, because it's expanding that. That's a good program. I do like that.
But still, for Badge of Care, you have to have children. There's a segment of the population that doesn't have children
that
fall
true.
Through the cracks. And, at one time I was one of those people. You know, I don't have kids, self-employed, mm-hmm. and insurance premiums are through the roof. You know, it was very, very difficult to get affordable health care. And, I know other people who don't qualify for Badger Care. So,
well, again, I would feel that an incentive to get people to take the minimum wage jobs and just to work would be the fact to offer them an incentive of health insurance. That's the way I look at it. I don't look at just giving health insurance to anybody and everybody. And I think that's what really I'm hearing, until you just made a statement which kind of identified more to where I would be more in agreement.
That's why I'm the wordsmith here, Dan.
I see. It's interesting, and when I asked you what a Republican was, you know, one of the things you said was that you didn't like regulation.
No.
And I hear this from Republicans.
I said less.
Less Republican.
Government.
But you really want to regulate family morals and things, don't you? Like you want to repeal Roe versus Wade.
I wish that was not a case. I really do.
But you are in regulation of morals, right? I suppose you didn't vote for the referendum banning same-sex marriage and civil unions. You wouldn't support that either, would you?
No.
No. But that's regulation.
But that was on the ballot, and I'm a voter. I wish it wouldn't be, but it was.
But you voted for it.
I voted to ban it.
Yeah, but that's regulation. You're banning a civil union for two people. Why do you want to do that?
Well, I have my own moral principles, and that's what I go by.
But that shouldn't be the law.
It shouldn't, but it's a fact of life that we are supposed to be a Christian nation, and we're not. We're sliding further away from the good Lord.
I see.
And that's my stance.
I thought our country was based on pluralism, where we could all practice any the religion we wanted to, not to practice a particular religion.
No, nobody's forcing you to have a certain religion or one religion. We're enforcing the right for somebody to have his Christian principles or her principles used.
Yeah, but you're
separation of church and state.
That always pops up, but then that's a little vague too at times.
How is it vague?
Well, let me put it this way. When the Constitution was founded, and I know you're an intelligent man, the fact is that the Constitution has stated that we were always made under God. The laws were made for a Christian nation. What happened?
All religions have a God.
Well, yeah, there's a God for Satan too. The people worship Satan as a God. I understand where you're coming from.
Okay. Well, I think these, you know, back to the 53rd District, this is, my reading of the 53rd District is these religious moral issues are going to play pretty prominently in the 53rd District because it is a very conservative Christian district. Isn't that right?
But even if it does, that's not really the issues here that we should be talking about. It's what I can do to further the future of the people that live in the 53rd District. And bashing or talking about gay marriages or whether I voted for bans is not the issue here.
What's your record?
Well, it's my record on one issue because I was forced into that, but I was honest enough to give you my honest opinion.
Okay.
If you want to talk about tax incentives and making health care, and I had other things involved, protecting the Second Amendment as a constitutional right, whether you own a gun or even care to.
It's in the Wisconsin Constitution. You don't have to run on that anymore.
No.
It's done.
But as far as constitutional law is, I think to a certain degree we're duty obligated to enforce the Constitution. And to interpret it.
As a legislator, you're going to enforce the Constitution?
Yeah, we are lawmakers.
What would you do? It's already in the Wisconsin Constitution. The courts ruled 5-4 decision against the D.C. ban on what would you do if you were elected that's any different than what it will be now? It's you won. Second Amendment people won.
Well, first of all, my biggest thing is to help the people out that need jobs and to keep jobs in Wisconsin. And I think that should be the focus rather than making it sound like I'm a gay basher or anything else, because that's far from the truth. Okay. I have friends that are lesbian and gay people, but I, by my nature, and people know me that way, I'm not a basher.
But you don't support them for to have marriage.
No, I don't, but I don't do it in a vicious way where, look at that guy or that gal or them two kissing or whatever. I don't care to do that. That's not the issue.
Do you consider them Christians, though?
They consider themselves Christian. I'll let the Lord judge that, not me. I don't judge people. If they feel that they're Christian and they're following Scripture.
Oh, but you do. Come on. You do when it comes down to voting one way or another for certain
things.
But
that's my principle. I'm not.
Right.
I understand.
And I have to be honest with my principle. Okay. You know, there's a lot of people today that I've met over many, many years that are two-faced. They talk one way and do another way. Mm-hmm. And I've come across a lot of those people. You're looking at somebody, whether you disagree with me or not, that is being very upfront. That's all I can be, is upfront. Mm-hmm. Whether you like or agree what I'm saying, that's what the issue is. What kind of a candidate do you have sitting before you? One that speaks out of two sides of his mouth? Or somebody that's upfront, even though you don't like to hear what I'm saying, I'm telling you from my heart that that's the way I believe.
Okay.
And I don't think I should be bashed for it.
I want to touch on something, and we've only got about 3.5 minutes left.
Oh,
so
gosh.
I know, it's terrible. you talk about tax incentives and so forth. We had some lobbyists on the show a few months back who they are trying to close a lot of the corporate tax loopholes, Dick, whereby corporations who are doing business in Wisconsin are finding ways to avoid paying corporate income taxes here. And, you know, this group is trying very hard to close those loopholes. I mean, it's going to be a long battle, but have you heard this?
Yes, I have. I guess the way I look at it is if you earned income in Wisconsin, you should pay tax like anybody else. Okay. I don't know what else, like how else I could answer that. I'm not for taxing the death corporations, because those are the people that expand their businesses based on tax cuts and hire people. I mean, the one that bothers me the most is the oil companies. They make such huge windfall profits that I could see taxing them to a point where they should be required to take some of that profit, depending on how much they make, and there's a formula for that, and put that in research for new energies and new exploration for oil and gas and other ways of providing energy. But as soon as we start taxing corporations as per se, any company or business, you don't have a company or a corporation that can expand. You have to be careful how much you tax to death somebody. And it's so easy to say, get the big guy. He makes 250 grand a year. But the thing is, that guy maybe gets an incentive where he invests that money so that it expands the economy in one way, shape, or another.
That's a different thing, though, than this. These people are just outright finding ways to avoid paying corporate
income taxes. I don't care for
that.
I really don't. You know, we have company. We're trying to keep companies in Wisconsin for what reason? For income, for jobs, so that we can get the revenue to support the budgets that we need to maintain, you know, a better Wisconsin. Not to send it outside. We've done that with jobs outside the country, and I mean that's hurt us to a certain degree. That's
sure,
really hurt us.
Sure. You have a
who do you think is your toughest opponent in this primary?
I don't look at just one person. I really don't.
Okay.
That would be foolish to do.
Interesting.
That.
One of your opponents, Mike Christensen, gave this to me at the fair. Or I mean, at the parade on the 4th.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't tell me which assembly race he's running for. It doesn't tell me he's a Republican. I've got the NASCAR schedule. I've got he's the new. Green Bay schedule.
He's kind of new.
But, you know, as a candidate, you should really tell me which party you are and which district you're running in. That would be helpful, I would think. That's not a particular.
Some of these people jumped in at the last minute, and they're trying to put together a first-time.
Yeah.
What's ironic about it, this is a 20-town district. It goes from the town of Oshkosh to Waupun.
Yeah.
And I don't think these people understand how huge it is and what you need to do to get started in a campaign like this. I want to talk real quick. Farming is another thing that I'm afraid people do not address farming.
Mm-hmm.
Farming is a concern. You know why? Because they're going out faster than we should have them going out. And I believe that they should be treated with tax incentives as well and tax credits to keep people on the farms.
Mm-hmm.
If they choose to stay on the farm, help them stay on the farm. Bread and milk is not manufactured, contrary to some of the people moving out in the country area in the back of Pick and Save. Believe me, we need the farms, we need the dairy. When I was a kid, it was called the fruit basket of the world, so to speak. You know, so I mean, you need farming is something I'm really concerned about.
It's mainly a federal support thing, though.
We're
more
out of time,
state.
Guys. Sorry.
That quick?
That quick.
That was
anyway,
it?
That was it. Anyway, thanks so much
for
being
here. What did you cut me off?
Anyway, thanks for being here.
Yeah, thank you
thank
very
you
much.
Very
we're going to try
much.
And get whoever wins the primary, we're going to try and get them back on Jeff Mann. Okay?
Yeah.
So,
good luck.
Thank
anyway,
you very
good
much.
Luck. Yeah. And thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time. Until then, take good care. Keep your eye on us. We've got our eye on us.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.